Good evening. Welcome to Trinity College. My name is Christopher Houlihan. I am college organist, director of chapel music, and artist in residence here, and it is my pleasure to welcome you to our chapel for tonight's performance. Whether you are joining us in person on this very rainy and humid evening in Hartford, or joining us online. Tonight's recital celebrates Trinity's outstanding pipe organ, built here in Hartford by the Austin Organ Company and dedicated 50 years ago. This instrument was a gift not only to the college, but to the greater Hartford community, and it has played a significant role in the college's musical offerings and academic programs since 1972. I'd like to begin this performance with one of Bach's greatest works for the pipe organ, the Prelude and Fugue in A minor. It was sometimes said that other organists of Bach's time wished that they could play with their hands what Bach could play with his feet. And I think this fugue especially demonstrates how much Bach enjoyed showing off. Here we go, the Prelude and Fugue in A minor.
Thank you.
Thank you. My hope for tonight's performance was that it would not only celebrate Trinity's organ, but also honor those who have played major roles in its successes over the years. And two of those individuals are Robert Edward Smith, chapel composer in residence, whose piece we are about to hear, and John Rose, one of my teachers and immediate predecessor, who recorded and premiered the work. This piece was written to demonstrate and showcase all of the many sounds and colors of a great pipe organ. And we are very lucky tonight to have a special guest to serve as our tour guide. Please join me in welcoming New England Public Media's classical music radio producer and host, John Nowacki.
The pipe organ is one of mankind's oldest musical instruments, which has evolved over more than 2,000 years. The first instruments resembling the pipe organ emerged around 200 BC. Groups of pipes were stacked on a box with keys under each pipe to control the flow of pressurized air. An organ's particular sound at any given moment is determined by the organist, who chooses which ranks of pipes to engage. The air can be stopped from entering pipes the organist does not wish to sound, and thus we have the term stop to describe the various individual sounds of the organ. Composer Robert Edward Smith has written a set of variations on an American folk tune to serve as an introduction to the sounds of the pipe organ, the instrument which Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart called the king of instruments. There are four families of pipes in the organ. The principals, the flutes, the strings, and the reeds. The foundation of the organ's sound. Other pipes may imitate other instruments, but the principal sound is unique to the organ. Mixture is a set of high-pitched pipes. It adds brilliance to the organ's sound. The which imitate their namesake, are lighter and clearer. The harmonic flute, however, is rich and full. The charming mutation stops are tuned to fractions of the octave and may produce unique effects. The strings have a warm, shimmering sound, not unlike their orchestral counterparts. There are a wide variety of reed pipes. Some make sounds similar to trumpets and trombones. Pigs are very versatile. They can be playful and humorous. But other reeds, like the petal bombard, can be snarly and sinister. Reeds can also be mellow and sumptuous, like the oboe. But for a grand effect, the trompette de jubilé, or solo trumpet, is without equal. Calls for all the colors of the organ in assorted combinations.
I'll share with you that it's so humid in here that the keys of the organ are actually sweating a little bit, as am I, but so sliding around a little bit here and there. I'd thank you, John, and thank you, Robert, for your wonderful music. Very grateful. Excuse me. The last piece on this evening's program is by Franz Liszt, his Fantasy and Fugue on Ad Nos Ad Salutarum Undam. And the title of this piece, of that theme, sounds like it might be an ancient Gregorian chant, perhaps, the Latin title. But this tune is actually from an opera, Meyerbeer's opera, The Prophet. And it was very common in Liszt's day for pianists. Liszt, of course, was really the first virtuoso pianist, first to play recitals and wow audiences. But it was very common for composers, Liszt and others, to write fantasias based on themes from operas, perhaps themes that their audience would recognize. And these pieces were rather fluffy. They're fun and show pieces that would wow and dazzle. But I think with this piece, perhaps because Liszt is writing for the pipe organ, which has all sorts of other connotations that go along with it, it seems like Liszt is aiming for something more profound. Perhaps the great romantic struggle between good and evil, or in this piece, sometimes it's a struggle between two different keys, the keys of C minor, in which the piece begins, and F sharp major, which harmonically speaking are about as far away as you can get. They're very far away. One feels like you are maybe in the depths of hell, and the other feels like you have ascended into the clouds. And these two harmonic musical forces are sort of at war throughout this piece. And of course, C major, in fact, wins out in the end with blaring trumpets and fanfares, and it's a very triumphant conclusion. But the journey that Liszt takes the listener on is operatic in scale from beginning to end. And you will hear, I think, all of the different colors and voices of the pipe organ on display, a lot like an opera, I think, in fact. This is one of my favorite pieces to share with an audience. It is colorful and exciting and tragic and beautiful. And it's a real treat to get to share it with all of you tonight. Here we go, Liszt's Fantasy and Fugue on Odd Notes. I didn't program one French piece tonight, so I thought I would end with a very beautiful and quiet scherzo by Louis Vierne. This is from his Second Symphony.